September 15th, 1992 is called to order. The first item on our agenda is adjustments to the agenda. Anyone opposed or?
Mr. Chairman, I would request that under the school board subcommittee's reports that I be allowed to add the community team report, please.
That will become item C under school board subcommittee's reports. Any other adjustments to agenda? I wish to announce a change in procedure. When I ask to entertain a motion, I would like my fellow board members to please state the motion so that it is clear to the secretary who's recording it. If that meets with your.
Sure, you gotta put us under the gun. I mean, we're all used to saying, "I so move."
I think it's a good idea.
You won't be getting so many motions, you recognize that.
That's true. It would help the secretary who's recording our motions so that she doesn't have to listen to every mouth of wisdom that comes forth from the board, and she can zero in on exactly what the motion is for our official report. I have a good sense of the board.
We'll try, right?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. The next agenda item is approval of school board minutes for the meeting of August 25th, 1992. Are there any adjustments or changes? Seeing none, they stand. Our next agenda item is comments by our middle school and high school representatives. We'll call on our middle school representatives first. And if they would come forward and sit in the chair. Thank you.
Hello. I'm sure Christy can't be here because of the change in location, so I'll read what we have. Seeing this is only the second week of school, there isn't a whole lot that's going on. But so far, soccer scrimmages are beginning soon this week, and our school's looking better than it did last year. There's artwork up, and the kids are pitching in to kind of make it look decent. And picture day for school will be this Friday, September 18th. And student election procedures are beginning this week and next. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, if we could hear from our high school representative, please.
Okay. As you know, our high school began last week with the new addition of the kindergarten class. And so far, it's been pretty successful. We've been really receptive to the new physical renovations that have been done because of the kindergarten kids, and it's really nice to have little people running around. But there still exists some legitimate problems gripe-wise among the senior class, because to this date, senior privileges have been taken away more and more to accommodate the kindergarten class. These senior privileges include a carpeted hallway where our lockers are kept, an official senior lounge, which is now the planning center, and the central area located by the main office, which was also a popular hangout with the seniors who have free periods. These changes have caused low morale and frustration for many who feel that the senior rank earns distinction. Two solutions that have been thought of to this include a carpet in the senior hallway, which was once part of the architect's blueprints for kindergarten renovations, and an open campus granted for seniors with parental consent. Considering that our class's achievements and responsibilities, including our MEA scores, always excel, it is felt that we have earned these privileges, and we ask you to take these into consideration.
Hi, first of all, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Mindy Hall. I'm the new school representative this year. I'm replacing Lori O'Donnell, who's doing a marvelous job as the chairperson of the SAC. Some things going on in the school since the start of school, some new things are, first of all, Stacia Davies and Sarah Warren, who are juniors at Cleve, have started an AIDS awareness club, and that's to bring AIDS awareness to the community, which is really good because it's new and it hasn't been started before. And it started to get off the ground last year, and I hope that it will grow more and more this year.
Let's see, there's our first high school dance this Friday, sponsored by the seniors. We're all looking forward to that. And I've heard in the freshman hallway, there's the freshman buzz that is going to be really cool, and so whatever. So that's pretty exciting for us because we want to put on a good dance for everyone so we can raise money for graduation. Also, to help the hurricane victims down in Florida and in Louisiana, the SEC is sponsoring a food drive with each class having its own box in the main office where they can bring their canned foods and whatnot. Also, the SAC is later on this month is having their annual retreat at St. Bartholomew's Church. So that'll be a good time to discuss what we plan for the year and get acquainted with our new members in the freshman class. Also, I have one question about the middle school building committee. I was wondering if there was going to be any student involvement, and if there was, in what capacity and what role the students would play.
Actually, very interesting meeting yesterday with, I think they're all seniors, students who are in a drafting class, and a year-long project, for their year-long project, they had made an appointment with me to come over and talk about that project, as well as some of the other renovation projects that we need to think about. I did, in fact, give them my one and only sketch of what we at least have as a general idea of where we're headed at this point. They're bringing it back to me once they trace it and copy it, and I have invited them to come to those meetings. Frankly, that wasn't done in a formal sense of getting represented. They identified themselves as three students who were looking for a drafting project, I believe. I don't know if they're interested in architecture and drafting or what, but from my conversation with them, I think that's true. And we welcome their presence, but we will also be interested in having, I think, other student input. What I discovered when I was talking with the boys was the two of them had been students in the middle school, and what certainly occurred very readily was the insights that students have about the inadequacies of that building. And I'm sure that many of you would like to call our attention to a variety of issues that you lived through, so we would like your input. But that is not the normal way we get representatives, but I think, frankly, if you have some other suggestions, we'd be open to them, but you will be represented in that way.
Very good.
Have a buddy program with the freshman this year?
No, that didn't get implemented this year.
It was just due to confusion of communications among senior officers and such. It's still a possibility, though. It's just we're in a state of confusion right now. It just opened to me.
Thank you.
Okay.
Welcome, Linda.
Thanks.
Our next item on our agenda is communications. Superintendent,
yes, I have one here. Actually, it's two parts, but our new commissioner, Leo Martin, is sponsoring, along with the representatives of the National National 2000, America 2000, and Maine 2000, a meeting on October 1st to discuss what's going on in Maine for that national initiative. The communication says that we could send a three-member delegation and suggest perhaps a school board member if anybody's interested in going. I, at the present time, do have intention of getting there myself, and if somebody would like to go with me, I'd be happy to have your company. And the some of these, I have a communication from fellow board member John Holt, who sent, as he does from time to time, sends me a copy of an article and asks me to communicate it with you. This one says, frustrations of serving on the school board. I thought perhaps you might like to read it. Thank you, John, for sending that along. I should have waited until after the meeting, but anyway. You did have, for communications in your packet, you had a copy of the existing contracts with sports teams that you had asked for. I simply pass those along to you at this point without comment. And I have one more communication. I've received a letter from Tom Tinsman, whose property abuts the high school parking lot. I'll simply read this and ask for some responses from you. Attached, you'll find a plot plan of my property at 349 Ocean House Road. The same plan was submitted to the planning board with approval recently granted for the development of a fitness center here. One suggestion the planning board made to me was that I make the site pedestrian friendly. In order to do this, I recommended the construction of a pathway from the back of my parking lot to the upper end of the high school parking lot. In order to do this, a section of the chain link fence dividing these properties would have to be removed. I believe that the school department owns a fence. For this reason, I'm seeking permission to create an opening in the fence at my expense wide enough to allow pedestrian traffic only. Please let me know what you think my next step should be. Thank you for considering this request. I thought that since I had just received this during the past week, the simplest thing to do was to bring it here under communications and ask you what your response is. On the one hand, it's a very simple request. On the other hand, I have found repeatedly as I start doing things that there are sometimes iceberg issues. I know we had a recent circumstance with a booster group trying to add electricity that we got into a few complications. I have not researched the situation. I just thought I would bring it to your attention. You may know this property better than I, and if you give me some guidance, I'd be happy to pursue it.
I'll respond as a member of the Town Center Subcommittee, which meets regularly and includes the property that Mr. Tinsman just described. And truly, one of the recommendations will be that there be pathways, walking pathways for people throughout the areas, interconnecting the schools and such. And I think it's, unless there is truly an iceberg there, certainly on the surface is something that is could be very positive for the school grounds.
Would that pathway be by the planning board a sidewalk type of pathway?
I think the, if I'm understanding the sketch correctly, as you can see, there's a walkway here, and apparently they're talking about simply making an opening so that in the most direct way possible, the car could be parked here and it's just access into the parking lot. I think that's all it is. Now, I will be happy to continue researching this and so on, but I thought before I started, I'd like to know if any of you have any history or background in this project or anything that you want me to be aware of.
Well, I think one thing we don't need is for our parking facilities to be used for private so if that.
I think we need to know the purpose of his wanting a
Well, why does the planning board, why did they make that suggestion?
Because the Town Center Subcommittee's preliminary plans that were, this is my report, by the way, the Town Center Subcommittee, but the report that was listed in the paper on Monday clearly suggests that there will be freedom of movement throughout the campus and to the businesses and ultimately along Route 77 from Fowler Road all the way through to the center of town in the long view. And every time a project is approved, they are doing it based on the condition that this will be the way things are in the future.
So people theoretically will be able to in the future go to the parking lot behind the IGA, which is ours, and walk through that fence into the IGA area.
And they can now.
Oh, what, can they? Yes. I thought that was fenced off.
Well,
is it a problem with parking? I've never seen that lot full. So why would this be a problem with parking?
I don't know. I was wondering if there were enough parking places for them.
It's a very, I happen to know that because I've parked in there recently and I just rough cut. Let's say there'd be room for 20 cars. It's hard to imagine that there would be more than that at any given moment in the fitness center. So
he's required to have enough parking places for the maximum use. Anyway, so I am almost positive that this is no benefit to him. And it is a requirement of his conditional approval, and it should not be detrimental to us.
Okay. Well, I will continue the research, and it sounds like unless there's something unusual it's not an issue with New Fisher Crossing. Except for that issue about.
So that's a really big parking lot, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I think it's a great idea to tie the town center pad, you know, together with pads. I think that's wonderful.
Okay, thank you. Those are my communications.
Okay, I have a communication which I received from Barbara Connell, who is a Spanish teacher at the high school, and I will read her communique. Our high school has established a partnership with a school in Valencia, Spain, and on September 18th, our first exchange begins. 11 students and their teacher will arrive and spend almost 3 weeks with us. I would like to extend an invitation to you and the other board members to join us in welcoming our visitors. There will be a reception for our guests Monday, September 21st, from 2 to 3 p.m. in the afternoon at the high school library. Sincerely, Barbara Connell. So if any board members could attend, I'm sure it would be greatly appreciated. I don't know what the reciprocal arrangement is. Do you have any idea?
No, I don't. I mean, I know that there is this reception. I mean, as far as after the students are here, what our students do?
What our students do?
No, I don't at this time.
It's a high school library?
High school library.
Do you want me to say something?
Perhaps.
Does Frank?
Yeah.
Head up tomorrow?
Do I need to go up there? For a number of years, we have had a relationship with a high school outside of Paris where students from that high school have come here. Students from this school have gone there for 2 or 3 week exchange visits. And as part of the effort that began 4 years ago when we changed the nature of the homestay program here, some of you will remember that and were involved in that. I have been working with members of the Language Department to establish a similar reciprocal relationship with a high school in Spain. And we have used the same agency that set up the high school in France. And it's taken us 2 years to do it just to find the appropriate school. So this is the first visit from this school to us. I do not know when we have planned a reciprocal visit. It may be next June. This was to be the initial one, and it's a question of getting our school years aligned and finding convenient times. But we hope this will be a long-term partnership between us and this high school, and we're very excited about it. And Barbara has worked very hard and has worked with her students and house families to create a wonderful schedule for these students for the next 3 weeks. So we're very pleased and excited. This will be excellent. And I think this will provide our students with a nice opportunity to go and be a part of an educational community when they go to Spain and a community and a school program. And it will be, I think, a very well-organized a series of visits that will pay us. I think that we're looking forward to it.
Okay. Our next agenda item is Superintendent's Report.
Okay, we've already had some comment about the kindergarten center, if you will, and that certainly does seem to have opened rather smoothly. Obviously some glitches, and I did hear what people were saying. I don't have any ready response. I don't really know all the background, but we really don't want the kindergarten center to displace high school. We would like this to be a happy marriage. But we will look into that. Other than that, the youngsters seem to be settled in well. The programs seem to be up and running. I know that the kindergarten teachers spent a lot of time getting things ready. We were nervous about, speaking of carpeting, getting the carpeting in, a few pieces of equipment, but I think it's fine. I also want to thank the parents and many community members who worked on Project Swing. There was a picnic that I think it was a Wednesday before school started, and numbers of parents and their children were here. I think well representing across section of the community, people who had taken part in both raising money for the equipment, but also putting it together, and it certainly, I thought, came out very well, and many people do feel that way. The high school students tried that equipment. I mean, you know, relive your youth. Just be careful. I don't know how much the equipment needs to be sturdy. Does anybody have any idea what that
out. Is? I watched the ceiling come down.
And a new dental program.
Monster grill. That is really something. As I was saying, we're sitting right under the kindergarten, so I don't know what that was. I think probably one of the things that is both a matter of great success, but also of a lot of trial, has been the issue of redoing bus routes and rethinking the way in which we've organized some of our busing, and the concomitant use of staff time for cleaning and maintenance and so on. Once again, I mentioned this several times during the summer, I want to compliment the staff, our custodial, maintenance, and bus driving staff for a lot of hard work and really a lot of, I had some comments about the improvement in the condition of the buildings. The person who deserves a standing ovation is Sue Weatherby, who out of an interest in reorganization and thinking through systems and in fact the ability to make that kind of thing work has spent an enormous amount of time rethinking the resources we have and how to make our whole approach in those areas more efficient and effective. And frankly, I think Sue is here. I just want to publicly say thank you. I also know, and having had many conversations with parents in the last week, that some of our opening school glitches on buses certainly did cause some consternation. I hope we have demonstrated that we will listen, we will respond to any reasonable request that we can straighten out quickly. We have done so. In some cases, there are some areas of the town we need to rethink how we set the routes up. We are willing to go out and look closely, and in fact we have a sort of review committee consisting of myself and a board member and Sue, and we have already been out doing that and make that offer to any parent who is concerned about that issue. We also had an opportunity to talk to some parents at the Pond Cove Parents Association, just trying to explain what some of the issues we have to take into consideration in providing busing. Safety is always a huge issue for us, and we do not want you to feel that there is an unsafe condition. But I should point out that some of the issues that occur at bus stops are largely, if not entirely, frankly, parent responsibility. It is our responsibility to provide busing, but the state actually has a general policy that we can require, and some districts do, K, including kindergarten, through six, if not eight, depending on where you cut the line at six or eight for elementary, to walk up to a mile. High school to walk up to a mile and a half. We do not do those things at all. And I just mention that to let you know what the state parameters for those kinds of issues are. We do try to be very aware of the limited number of sidewalks in the town. Many times a development that has no sidewalks but also has very little traffic, we try to take that into consideration. We are very appreciative of the parents who are pooling their time and efforts to monitor bus stops. And frankly, as I've traveled through towns on my way to work in the past and now if I'm going through other towns, I see a lot of parents standing at the beginning of a development or standing sometimes with their cars in rainy weather. So this is a generally accepted way of dealing with some of these issues. We appreciate your help. If you have questions and concerns, please do feel free to call. I've received calls. I know Sue's received a lot, and the Community Services Office. We appreciate that in a busy season for them, we think, keeping up with them. I think at this point you're probably seeing considerable improvement. It takes a week to two to get new bus routes up and running. Whatever glitches we have left, we do feel we can manage. And I just want, in closing on that, want to make one more point. Our goal was to eliminate as much as possible and cut back on what we call the double runs, which meant that kids would have to wait at school for the second run in the morning, would have to come very early and wait, and in some cases up to a half hour or even more. We have greatly reduced that. We have not been able to eliminate it totally, but we certainly have reduced that, and we think that that's a real plus. Other than that, as far as opening of school is concerned, you have in your packet the enrollment figures. This does not break down class by section, but you will see they are so close to what they were last year that for the most part, the classroom division numbers are roughly the same also. And that as we go on, we'll give you those individual classroom division numbers so you can see where they stand. But we, last year we had 1,619 students. This year we, actually, I guess that was last year, last month, that would have been the September enrollment. We have 10 more students system-wide this year. Obviously lost some, gained some, staying virtually the same. I would point out that we, our reorganization of the kindergarten here and the fourth grade back into Pond Cove, we do have room for everybody. Some facilities are tight. Some people, of course, are sharing, especially our splinter services where some people are sharing two or three small made spaces. But so far, we're in, operating, and other than some of the glitches that I've noted, I think it was a notably smooth beginning of school. Of course, some of the things that, when you're in the middle of some of the other things, it doesn't feel so smooth. But the reality is, the larger picture was that it was a good beginning of school.
On behalf of the board and the community, again, I want to thank Sue Weatherby, her custodial staff, and the student high school hires this summer for an outstanding job. The staff on the opening day of school applauded. So they were very appreciative of what they came back to. Setting the subject for the September 29th school board workshop.
Okay. One suggestion that has been made to me is to focus on the high school. I think I as our high school representative, so we haven't gotten that. And one issue that we have talked about briefly in our goal-setting workshop that I've also had conversations with individual board members as well as with high school staff and with Frank Miles. The high school has, for the last 2 years, had some funds from the Coalition of Essential Schools given to those school districts that have indicated an interest in examining whether or not this community, this school, wants to go in that direction, wants to actually look into and make a decision on that. At this point, it would be my recommendation that we use this workshop in September to review that. I don't believe, at least while I've been superintendent, that we've had a workshop or, for that matter, a report on exactly where we stand on that, and the grant does run out this year, and a good decision-making process for something as important as that takes time. So I would suggest that we start the year looking at that. That doesn't mean that there won't be other related high school issues that you would probably, in fact, that is such a broad decision in and of itself. It encompasses many of the themes that I heard people talking about last year. So I would recommend that that's what we do in the 29th.
This was also the board chair's recommendation. There's another topic that the rest of the board would like to concentrate on, express their interest or their concern at this time. And we will set the workshop for a study of the Coalition of Essential Schools.
Mr. Chair,
yes.
Are we going to actually firm up the goals for the board itself at this meeting tonight, or is there another time that we need to meet?
I believe that the superintendent has put a distillation of what she garnered from our goals in our packet, and I believe she's going to discuss it.
Yes.
Yeah, that's on the agenda, but I'm wondering if it will be final. Will there be a discussion tonight, or will it be finalized, or how are we going to end up with the goals?
Might I make a suggestion, please? My sense from having talked to
most of you individually, not necessarily all, but is that, as I, we can get into this in more detail, that some of this is fairly straightforward, and that I think many of your goals are already, except for maybe some slight rewording, in pretty good shape. I expressed my concern about the instruction section because I was concerned about how to frame those in a way that I could work with staff and administration to make sure that we had some fairly clear set, fairly established end products that we could look at. I'm prepared to discuss that with you tonight, and I think we can get, my sense would be that we can boil that down to a few items that is obviously up to you people to tell me whether you are satisfied with that, that may result in one more rewrite to tighten up the wording and so forth, and putting it on the October agenda for adoption, after which, of course, it's disseminated to the schools. If you're satisfied with that, I thought we had the topics in there. I was just concerned about the way they're stated.
Next is the regular school board meetings and workshop dates.
And I just wanted to point out to you, you have that in your packet. Tuesday, December, the December date is wrong. It shouldn't be the 15th, it should be the 8th. Once again, I think this is useful to have to put on your calendar. We know that as of, for instance, today's date, we deliberately chose to put it at the 3rd rather than the 2nd Tuesday because of coinciding with the opening of school. And clearly, those things happen. I would just point out to you that a similar issue, if you look at your calendar for June, exists also. Tuesday, June 15th is actually the 3rd Tuesday in June. But since the charter requires you to have an organizational meeting at the same time that the town council has the organizational meeting, if we don't change the regular meeting, you're going to be in a rather strange situation where you have a June meeting without having had an organizational meeting with new members of your board. So we felt that that was the only sensible thing to do. The other thing is that we, as we did last year, we're putting down dates for the 4th Tuesday, with the exception of September 29th, I believe actually officially is the 5th Tuesday, isn't it? I think it must be. And we also note that in November and December, the 4th Tuesdays would fall on days when we really anticipate that you would not be terribly motivated to have a workshop because of the conflict with various holiday schedules. So this is intended to be an indication, not carbon concrete, but we thought it would be helpful for you.
Why are we going to add policy subcommittee night, which will meet October, Monday, October the 5th?
Yes, it is.
Which would be the first Monday.
What time?
And I think we, I asked if we could make that at 12:30.
Wait.
No, can't do that? Do you have a conflict? I have, that's a conflict with the, we were talking about the team. I realize we have that. I have the first Monday of every month, superintendent's meeting with the partnership, Southern Maine Partnership.
Wednesday.
I could do it on Wednesday.
10 o'clock.
10 o'clock.
Wednesday before the school board meets the following Tuesday.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah, so that's the 7th. Is that right? 7.
Mm-hmm. 10 o'clock.
10. Okay.
So that will become your standard policy yes. committee for the month.
Yes, yeah, so that's the first. The first
for
Wednesday of each month.
Yes.
Okay. Very good.
The superintendent's office.
Yes, that's where I have files. And the policy book is at the point where I don't really want to carry it around and I have to, so that would be very helpful for me.
If there's a desire or wish from the board to have a workshop in November or December,
yes. In fact, I think it's rather regularly a good idea to have some kind of workshop early in December. I really would anticipate that we'll be talking about some building issues. Maybe that's a little early,
but given the timeline, we'll discuss this a little bit later in this meeting, but I think it's entirely possible that that's what we'll be using some time for.
I guess I would like to see us be willing at least to have some other workshops. It seems going 2 months without a workshop is a really long time, and I think we have an awful lot on our plate.
I think it works out very well to look at, a workshop doesn't have to be a Tuesday.
Right.
As long as we look at respective calendars and what's going on. I know we did that last year when we had, we were into the discussion of the building space study. I forget exactly when we had that, but I know we had something like that.
We did some on Thursday.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We had set a pattern. I think what the superintendent was trying to show that there could have been, there could be some conflicts in those 2 months. It's not saying that we don't want a workshop. Mm-hmm. Okay, moving on to school board subcommittees and reports. The first will be the finance subcommittee report from Rosemary Reed, the chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I want to report that prior to this meeting, the finance subcommittee met and received the revenues and expenditure report according to the budget from the business manager, and there were no remarkable columns, except of course to note that many supplies have been purchased in textbooks, which allow for more than a proportional expenditure in those accounts, but they're mostly a one-time expense. One of the items that we discussed, and many of the high schoolers have left, but the vending machine will be returned to the cafeteria as soon as next week. It'll be a newer and more up-to-date and more variety. Quite importantly, last night at the town council meeting with the chairman of the school board, the superintendent, myself present, the town council voted to approve the expenditure of $15,400 to be placed into a dedicated fund to be used for oil tank removal, which because of a state mandate will have to be completed in the next year or so. And they also allowed an account with a dedicated fund to be established in the amount of $50,470, which will be used to offset costs attributable to the upcoming middle school project and no other reason. Specifically, that account can be used for planning costs such as architects' fees, site surveys, and various other related costs that we will have to incur before the building project goes out to referendum. The finance subcommittee at the last school board meeting did ask the superintendent to prepare a memo and ask the town council to do this, and we thank very much the town council for their support in this continuing progress towards the final end. And that is the end of my report.
Thank you. The next is Town Center Committee, and our representative is Rosemary Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to report that the Town Center Subcommittee meets at 7:30 on September 23rd. And at that meeting, we will be discussing the uses of buildings and structures and lots in the town center area, and that I would like to refer everyone who has not read the Monday paper, which outlined, I believe it was Friday's paper, that outlined very well in the local section exactly what the Cape Elizabeth Town Center Committee would be doing, and that committee will make its final recommendations to the town council by December.
Next is the community team. Rosemary Reed is our representative.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to report that the community team is having a meeting Wednesday the 23rd at 7 o'clock in the high school. I will not be attending. I alternate months as to which meeting I go to. In room 205, and on the agenda is the review of the application of the drug-free schools money, and also to discuss the process in order to form a new community team board. I do suggest that anybody's interested in serving to make their interest known and either call me and I will relay the word, or please appear at the meeting September 23rd in High School Room 205. Thank you.
We now move on to unfinished business. First is discussion and action on charge of middle school building committee.
I have here the wording that came, it was somewhat modified from what was in the packet. For those of you who were at the meeting, I don't know if you watched it on TV, but we had some discussion during the presentation of this as to would calling this or having the charge be tied solely to the middle school be too narrow a focus. As a matter of fact, I had been having some concerns about that myself because I knew that we have already identified that major renovation is needed at both the middle school and Pond Cove. The middle school happens to be a larger building with more acute needs, but that I did not want anybody to lose sight of the fact that this is a two-building problem. So that in the course of the discussion with the town council, it turned out that they, at least some of the members, also shared that concern. I suppose they must have remembered the space report, or simply their own view of how important it is to make these decisions, recognizing there's a larger context in one building. So you'll notice that the charge committee purpose, and would you let me just to read that?
Yeah.
The purpose of the committee is to study alternative options for improvements to the Cape Elizabeth Middle School, to recommend a construction plan and budget to the school board and town council, and to assist the superintendent of schools with advice on specific construction-related decisions. The committee shall also review all construction issues in the context of the master plan for the school campus. We didn't necessarily call the space study report a master plan, but it does have that flavor, and it does, in fact, it was in fact an attempt to look at all three of the buildings. So I'm very, again, I would echo Rosemary's comments about thanking the town council for their support. I did also, in response to a question about what would be the tentative deadline for a report, I said, well, you know, given my brothers, I would like to see this thing move along sooner than later, and mentioned that there is a referendum in May, and then who knows, they might be ready. We also, of course, discussed the fact that that's something that clearly we're not going to jump at just to jump at it, but we did a lot of work last year. There is a lot of data available to us. Once this committee is put in place, I think it will not take us a great deal of time to review that material and to look at the next important issue, which is a specific timeline for the architectural work for concept design, and also a lot of discussion about how to get out to the community, how to explain needs to individual different sections of the community. And then I think also to look at the issues that involve Pond Cove. One thing that hasn't necessarily been focused on in these discussions, and I think it's time for me to make sure people are well aware of it, all of this planning has to take into consideration how the kids are going to go to school. We are talking about a 3 to 5 year plan. And that means that we must have suitable places for the children to go to school. We do not have any empty school buildings. And we are talking about buildings that are so large. All of our, both of these buildings, Pond Cove and the middle school, are holding hundreds of students. And this is not something that is going to lend itself to just saying, well, we can close off one wing and deal with it. That's why I thought last year that the middle school proposal that starts with new building not only would yield a better building in the long run, but also is probably the only way that we are going to have an orderly plan or how kids go to school in an appropriate setting while major renovation is going on. I mean, you cannot pull out all the heating and replace it. I mean, it took us all summer to do the relatively minor things that had to be done for the kindergarten. It is the reality of construction. So as we put all this together, I just want to make the, you know, truth in lending up front. This is not a quick and easy thing, but we've spent a lot of time looking at it, and I have to say that I'm quite confident and would want to reassure both the board and parents and the community and staff
This is all doable. And many of us have been through similar projects, and believe me, with good planning, you'd be surprised what you can do. So I don't think anybody should feel alarmed about it, but it does require good planning.
On the committee purpose, when it says to study alternative options for improvements to the Cape Elizabeth Middle School, does that mean that the work that was done last year and the vote that we took on that one particular option is going to be redone?
I don't think so. I mean, actually, this wording comes directly from the town manager, but in my conversations with him, my conversations with the council and any of our things, I certainly do not believe that that's the intent. It was probably the intent to just make sure that this committee reviews the work that has been done. The board has already spoken for its preference. If some notable opposition to that preference occurs in the course of a building committee, which by the way is not an unheard of proposition. There are many stories about building committees and what happens when one group gets together and then there is another group and so on. It would be my fond hope that we will not get bogged down in some kind of argument about that. Frankly, to me, we covered so much ground last year, I would not worry about that at this point. I might be wrong, but I don't think so. I think, however, the intent was to make sure that the building committee was at least up to speed as to what were these options. Study in that sense rather than necessarily try to ask the board to back away from a previous discussion.
There has not been a site review, so we don't know if the terrain will allow for what we want. It might have to be placed somewhere else. So that's the type of alternative that he's referring to. Mm-hmm. There was some discussion by the council about the committee process of establishing the committee. And they have an appointments committee process, and your board chair agreed to be a part of that process in selecting members from the general public to bring to the board for recommendations. I would ask a couple of board members to also join that appointments process. I believe they have three members on their appointment. And so if there are two fellow board members who would like to be a part of the selection committee. I would also like to extend to the general public if they see show an interest in becoming a part of this building committee, that there is an application process through the town manager, and if you would apply. There has not been a deadline set, and I believe there would have to be some kind of public announcement for advertisement.
Mr. Chairman, I was going to ask you, Debbie Pizzo will be doing the advertising as the town clerk for those positions, and I did serve on the appointments committee when I was on the town council. And we have a timeline that we have to be pretty careful about, and I would just respectfully request that the chairman of the appointments committee and the chairman of the school board set something up pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. Also, I've had three people approach me, and I have sent them all to you. So if you don't get applications in the next couple of days, then maybe we should advertise in the Cape Courier and things to let people know that it is a formal written process. I know you said that, but just to make sure that it's not, the chairman's going to call somebody up and his best friend's going to serve on the committee. This is a very open, in the sunlight, sunshine process, and we need applications.
Well, we should definitely advertise it, is what you're saying.
I think they have a process for committee application.
Well, the concern from some of the people were, gee, it doesn't affect my kids. Gee, I don't have kids in the school system. And my position has been, that doesn't matter. We need interested people who make logical decisions and are informed to serve on the committee. So there are some people who think, unless it's going to affect their kids, they shouldn't apply. And I don't think that that's...
We also need people who have a historical perspective on education in this community and a concern about that.
This is a wonderful opportunity for this community. The decisions that are going to be made and the ultimate improvements, both architecturally, programmatically, aesthetically, however you want to put it, in those two buildings are going to last for the next generation. And It is truly an exciting moment for this community that would like to think that, you know, we're not interested in being trendy. I don't think that we're interested in being forward-thinking. What are the educationally appropriate settings that need to be put in place for the next century? That's what this committee is going to be doing. Now, clearly the staff has ideas. We've talked about input from the staff. Architects are, you know, working with other school districts. There are a variety of things that are out there for communities now really looking at that question. But even though this is a tough time economically, we are talking about a town investing and planning for the educational setting for the next generation, not just for the kids who will be coming in at first. But what we are going to do is put these buildings in the kind of shape that lasts for 30 years. And I think we're getting a handle on how to plan for maintenance and how to plan for upkeep so that they'll be in good shape in 30 years, especially if they're planned well. So I just think it's a great opportunity for the community to come forward. I haven't had this opportunity for 20 years, actually over 20 years. The building we're sitting in is the last building that was planned for the educational program in this town. That's a fairly long stream. So, anyway, my pep talk for the evening.
Yes.
Are we going to go away tonight knowing when we're going to have this committee in place or not?
I will take the charge of my fellow committee member and contact the chairman of the appointments committee, which is Wayne Creelman, and we will set up a time frame, and I will bring that back to you.
I'm also wondering, just from listening last night and listening to what's being said here, is the thought behind this that this committee will then disband or there will be an additional committee for the Pond Cove project? And when that comes down the pipe, or is that?
I don't know. I mean, I can't tell you that at this point. I think that there are options. I mean, conceivably, you could talk about a grand scheme where you did them both together. I don't have any idea at the moment whether that's A, feasible, or B, prudent, but the time has come for us to, as I said, to have a plan for how we're going to do it and carry on school. And so some of the answers to that question have to come with what are the spaces that we have available for kids to go to school while we're doing these other things. That will drive some.
I'm just wondering because members of the public who may be interested may not be interested in serving on this committee for 2 years. They may be interested in a discrete part of it or something, so to the extent we could give that kind of guidance, it would be helpful.
I think if people would be willing at this point to commit a year of their life, that would be all we could ask.
I think a lot will depend on our next unfinished business agenda item and if this becomes a part of the total picture. I also extend to my fellow board members, I have to appoint two board members to serve on that committee. If anyone shows an interest, please let me know sometime in the near future. And I assured the town council that we have two people who are interested. We have two people, but I want to extend the invitation to all my fellow board members. Any further discussions? We are moving on. Next is a discussion and action on application to the state for special project at Pond Cove.
Okay. And you may recall last April, actually I brought it to you from the March meeting in order to get it in on time. I brought to you a packet, at that time somewhat unfinished, but ultimately you saw the finished product. Large packet, I think it probably has 50 pages in it all told. The special project I have simply summarized here, and I'll go through this in a minute, but I just want you to know that I have to totally resubmit that 55-page packet. Fortunately, it can be resubmitted with little or no changes. The changes would be updating it for this year. The changes of Princess and Middle School is now 5-8, Pond Cove is K-4, and adjusting the student population and those pieces that were particular to the year in which you put it in. The rest of it is all background data, much of it taken from our space study. Fortunately, our secretary this evening, April Secretary, is been working on that with me before, and so she is we're halfway through the project, I guess, but I don't have it all together right now. I should have mentioned earlier that Connie Brown is on vacation and that Sue Coffey is taking the notes tonight, if you all know some. The project overview, then, very briefly. Pond Cove is an elementary building currently housing all the children in grades 1 through 4. I probably should state that more clearly. What I'm trying to simply indicate for the purposes of the application, this is a town that doesn't have multiple elementary buildings. The building consists of two separate buildings now joined together by a portable unit which houses the media center and two special education classes. There is no gymnasium or auditorium. The physical education classes, assemblies, and lunchroom activities all forced to use a small all-purpose room. Our project asked for an addition to provide a suitable gym assembly space that replaced the existing portable structure. A recently completed school space study has established a need for renovating most of the existing structures at Pond Cove School. In addition, this study, as well as our own experiences, emphasizing an adequate space for the entire physical education program for these grades. Our current space needs for enrollment purposes have been alleviated by transferring the kindergarten to available space at the high school. However, we have no way to provide appropriate program space. We are applying for consideration of an 8,000 square foot special space project that would provide a gymnasium appropriate to the needs of children this age. In addition, we are asking for state help in meeting code requirements as related to the renovation of the existing spaces, as well as replacing the portable media center with a permanent structure. The reason why this is coming in at a different time from the middle school project is that from the way the state looks at these things, there is a whole strand of applications. It's called special projects. It's tied to 8,000 square feet, which would roughly cover the things that I have there, even though I don't have exact square footages. At this point, that's sufficient to give the background along with the data we have and a few other statements about why we would need that. Frankly, after going through this other process and realizing that we are not competitive with those districts that do not have enough square footage to house their students, it's a major lack of competition. Our need is as great as any community putting it in as far as the condition of the buildings or the lack of space, but we do have the square footage. Therefore, we will probably not rank very high on this list either, but I felt that I should go through the same process. I would ask you to take a vote to back the application. You know from going through this before, it doesn't commit you to doing anything, just to putting it in and seeing what happens. And then we will, I would expect to know sometime by perhaps as early as December, more likely January, and we'll be into the discussion of all of this with the building committee, and it will be another piece of data to look at.
Is there anybody from the public who would like to address this application? Seeing none, is there anybody on the board that would like to comment on this application? Seeing none, I entertain a motion. Rosemary.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we authorize the superintendent to continue the action for the application to the state for a special project at Pond Cove School.
Second from Jan. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor? 6-0.
Thank you.
Our next unfinished business is school board goals for 92-93 school year.
Well, basically, I just want to review with you that in the goals that that I summarized for you for our last meeting, those that are under improving communication, building issues, contract issues, and budget system management issues and board tasks, I feel very comfortable with those. I would perhaps, in the final draft, reword them a little. Maybe a couple of them are very close in meaning. I could do a kind of editing job on them. But I think that looking at them as your superintendent, I can understand what it is we could do as a staff to implement those goals. Things, for instance,
such as continue the community dialogue process with meetings regarding higher standards, et cetera. There's a clear set of issues that I can see there that we can work on. Obviously, when you get down on the building issues, get the building program underway and so on, those are the real very concrete issues that I can see. So that, again, on the budget and system management, most of those things are, I think, fairly either translatable as they stand or with only a fairly small amount of editing into goals that we can look at the end of the year and say, yes, we did this and this and this, we didn't get this done, or we, you know, how far did we progress? And I have learned to be very careful about stating board goals or stating system-wide goals, particularly at a time where I think this system is. We've done a lot of work of identifying the big picture. We are definitely at an implementation stage, and I want to be careful that what you, the direction you're giving to me and to the staff, is something that, that we think we can do and that we understand what it is that you are asking of us. So that's why I'm raising these issues of how we word them. I think I understand the intent, but translating it into programs that we can look at the end of the year and say, yes, okay, this, you know, hopefully this meshed with what you want. I'd like to have that discussion now so that as we move through the year, we don't have any misunderstanding. That's what I was concerned about under the first section, student performance and programs. This is a series of statements that we have talked about, raise standards in student education, continue to put emphasis on standards and outcomes, make substantive changes in our programs so that students have a curriculum appropriate for their needs. I don't think any of us would quarrel with any of those goals, but I'm wondering if we could, we should look at the way in which we word them. I enclosed the comments that Jan had put together because I think they present an interesting way to look at that. The board can set goals by asking the staff to give reports. That is, we want a report on assessment, we want a report on various kinds of curriculum issues. And I've had some discussion with the administration, not at this point a great deal on these issues, but some preliminary, and have talked about this with some of you individually. My recommendation would be that we take three or four of these major issues that have already been determined and turn them into a report for, a request for workshops, reports, discussions, and I think we need to talk a little bit, taking the idea of the goal consolidation, but also talking a little bit about what we think might actually work. That is, what are the pieces here that we can actually deal with? So I'm suggesting that you have some conversation about that this evening. If you're asking me for where I would put the emphasis, I would talk about, I think we've already talked about the high school, and the high school need to examine decision-making processes, whichever way it makes a decision, as a the high school of this town with the parent community, the school board, students and staff, that's an excellent focus. There are other issues that have to come up in looking at that, but that is a specific focus, and in making that decision, some of the issues that are talked to you about, the less is more thing, the grading issues, I know the honors issues that people were talking about last year are bound to come up because they are part of the kinds of issues that get raised by discussion of those principles. I mean, looking at what other school districts have looked at, I would feel that that would almost inevitably be part of that discussion. The issue that I would tag for the curriculum, I definitely intend to continue both the large system-wide committee that I put together last year with some change in composition. I intend to pick up on the issues of system-wide workshops, training, whatever, staff development, how to look at the system system-wide so that the curriculum is seen in that light rather than a series of unconnected steps, and that's certainly something I want to take responsibility for. I think we should also continue our individual subcommittees. We have language arts, mathematics education,
I think it's extremely important, and I think that's what, Jane, you were emphasizing here, for us to talk a lot about assessment. Is how, if we are talking about goals of raising standards, how do we know the standards have been raised? And I think that asking us to come back with specific reports or analyses, you know, how do we use data? And one of the suggestions I would give you along assessment lines is I would like to see us come together, staff and board, sort of in a spirit of inquiry. We could bring to you the standardized testing that we use, including pieces of the MEA. Suppose we were to take, for instance, the writing stream. We don't have complete copies of those tests, by the way. The state doesn't give them to us, but we have sample questions, we have sample pieces, and we have the analysis that does get sent back to us from the computerized report. And rather than trying to give you a workshop or a series of meetings on assessment that sort of, you know, is everything, focus on two or three issues and have it as a kind of general workshop. These are the issues. This is what, when we look at that data, what does that tell us? And I hear your questions. What are your issues? What else? I think it's appropriate for us to start talking about some of the efforts at portfolio assessment that teachers are using. It's far from a perfect way of dealing with authentic assessment, but we're going to hear a lot more about that. Those conversations about assessment, what does a standardized test do and what doesn't it do? I think that's what I would recommend that we go into. Those are the areas, and I think I have a feeling I've left one or two out, but those are the areas that I would like to deal with. I'd like to pick up on the idea of focusing on some large issues that, like the decision at the high school, the assessment issues, particularly taking one or two strands and really looking in depth, hopefully across the curriculum too, I mean across the grades. That's what I'd like to.
Comments from the board?
I think we need a workshop in the end. We have a lot to do. I like the way this is being done, but I am hearing everything that we have set clearly in our own individual words that we want done. I think we ought to revisit that other issue and set a meeting for November. And yeah, we have a lot to do.
Can I ask for clarification? I don't understand that. I mean, are you asking? I think that if you spend too much time setting this year's goals,
implementing. I think you've done I think you've done an outstanding job in capsulizing what it is, the essence of what we all, in our own words, want to have done. And I think that's what we now have to do is not worry so much about the exact wording. And we have to look at the implementation of the goals and how they are going to be monitored
So you're suggesting something along these lines that would be a workshop in October, I would assume, on some kind of assessment. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Somewhere along those lines?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm not being real clear because I was trying to, it's all moving around quickly, but we need to not spend a lot of time on worrying about the actual wording,
mm-hmm. Okay.
And get going on solving some of these problems that we have all in our, or many of us in our own individual ways, have identified to be core issues.
What we're really saying then is that we're going to set our goals by the workshop schedule that we set. I mean, we can really have our goals embodied in our workshop schedule. For instance, we're worried about assessment and raising standards and all that, and that can really be encapsulated in a workshop. I would hope, frankly, that one would be sooner rather than later, October rather than later than that, and then discuss that with the administrators and parents or whoever else is here and set the system in motion, because I'm a little concerned that the school board set the overall direction and not try to micromanage, but to set the direction and then ask for follow-up at some later date to make sure things are on track.
I think that is a good idea, except that I would think for the system to know what we have in our heads, that somehow it's got to be in a written form so they have an idea of where we're heading instead of month by month, this is what we're looking for.
Right, but we may not have to refine this terribly much more, but have this plus a workshop schedule. I would think we should be able to do that. You know, not just month by month, but sit down and figure out a schedule so they know what's coming up and they know what's expected of them and when we're going to be looking for.
Rosemary.
Is it a safe comment, Connie, that pretty much we all said the same thing?
I think there's a high degree of similarity. I did try to summarize some of this. It falls along much more neatly when we talk about discrete tasks. But when we get into student performance and programs, I see two threads at least. One is the higher standards. I mean, we had that in spades. Our mission statement clearly states that the desire of many parents as well as the board members. That's in here in a lot of ways. The other strand is to maximize individual potential. In other words, it isn't a matter, I hear from what you're saying and from the goals you put down, I hear that you don't want children to have a worse education because the standard bar is being raised. What you really are asking us is, can't we make this a better and more challenging learning situation for everybody? And to sort that out. And I heard that last year too. I think it's a very consistent thread through the both of those threads.
But it seems as though we're losing some ground because I believe that some of the class sizes are just growing. What they're doing is just putting more at the top. Is that true, Frank?
I'm sorry?
I mean, would your junior English, for instance, your junior English AP section, do you know how many students are in that section?
I think this year there are about 17 in that.
I was told there were 26.
That's in the honors section. I think there are 28 in that. The AP is relatively the right size. The honors is quite large.
So those are how many? 28?
The last number I heard was 28, 28. Yes.
So that's 5 over the recommendation.
That's right.
So, see, I see it's backsliding in areas that I thought were already reconciled.
As far as the eyes?
Well, as far as class sizes at the high school.
At the high school. Well, I think that is clearly part of the discussion. Again, I really think that a good program of analyzing the decision about the coalition school will have to bring up this whole issue about how do you stream kids, or how do you, I mean, it's a form of tracking, obviously, and to what degree that should be done, if so, how, not at all, what have you, but that has to be part of the discussion. Did any of you happen to see, I think it was on TV last night, but I also don't remember where I saw it, Boulder, Colorado? High school, with the where you take a semester course at how many hours did you see?
It's a 4-period day, a half year term subject. So you take, instead of taking English for a full year, you would take it for a half year, but you would have more time because you only have 4 periods in a day. So you would take 4 subjects. Mm-hmm. So you would take 8 subjects a year. But there would be more time involved and more concentrated. But it was essentially reinventing the school and reconfiguring the school. Yes. Right.
Yeah, there are several Colorado schools that do that, and Wells High School is doing that this year here, I believe. And they chose deliberately to do that rather than the kind of 4-period day that we were proposing that went every other day. This you go every day, but it's much more intensive.
And those conversations, which are tied to what is it you want to accomplish and what are the various ways in which you can accomplish it, have to go on. And then that's why
from a standpoint of a goal, my purpose in emphasizing and tying that to a discussion of the coalition is that you have to decide that issue, whatever decision you make about the coalition. That kind of decision-making process brings out that issue. What do you want?
I guess I would want to be sure that if we went this route, that out of these workshops and even in the anticipation of them, there would be administrators would have some kind of action plan for dealing with it, rather than we just discuss it and say that's a nice idea, now maybe next year we'll get around to doing something about it. So that's my only concern about continuing to simply having an agenda of talking about things, is that we have some sort of concrete process so that we make sure that ideas are implemented.
That's why I think it's important to have not only a beginning workshop on the topic,
yeah,
but a follow-up workshop at the end to see just what progress has been made, because we've had lots of discussions.
Mm-hmm. I know. I'm concerned about that, too. I mean, in other words, translating the general goals, which I think we did a fair job of getting out last year and hearing from the public and hearing from staff, I think there are a lot of those goals that are already sifting through in some specific ways in practice. I mean, I would not want to say, you know, all is done or anything even remotely like that. But this is a very critical year. All my experience teaches me that to go from a broad and hopeful vision to the step-by-step choice, because you never can change everything overnight. I mean, more good ideas have gone down the tubes because people have tried to change everything, you know, like we're impatient to get to that mountain. We can't do that. What we can do is see where we have made some changes. I think that historical perspective is really important. You know, where are the pieces that the board feels concerned about, because you obviously feel that you made a decision and somehow it didn't do it. And I know some of those things now. We'd be sensitive in working through with the staff. I think that, you know, what we need to say, I see if I can rewrite these so it says, boiling them down to three or four seminal issues, and what you're asking for is an action plan with the plan and then an assessment or a report, and then, you know, this is what happened. If this worked for these reasons, it didn't work for these reasons, and this is what we're going to do next. I think that's what you're asking about.
And some of that could be in a report going to the board,
yes,
at a board meeting. It doesn't necessarily have to be a workshop, so we don't have to plan everything to be a workshop.
I think we should go back to that, having a report. We've tried that before, having a report about something, some issue that's at every meeting.
And I think we as a board could set our priorities and submit those to the superintendent, and then she could present them to us at our October meeting.
Okay.
Are there still some issues about the goals? Do you want the superintendent to try to collate the goals a little more specific than they are listed? She's willing to make that attempt.
Okay, I will do my best. But I think what I hear, what I'm concerned, we're all concerned about the same thing. We really don't want empty rhetoric. None of us do. Because we really all want to get somewhere. This is not an exercise in trying to just, you know, keep people sort of happy. I mean, this is a real exercise in trying to figure out how step by step we actually make progress. And that's very different from just a lot of buzz.
Well, and I think we need to build on our successes. I mean, it seems like in education you just get going and get established and understand what you're doing, and then it's time to try something new. That's why I worry about the coalition. You know, I would rather us be doing what we're doing now well than start out into something altogether new.
The issue
is the same people that have difficulty doing what's happening now well.
I guess the only answer I have to that is that the coalition isn't necessarily something new. It may, in fact, only be reinforcing that. One of the issues that I want to be clear, I haven't made up my mind on that issue. But what I want is a good decision-making process so that we know what we want to do. And I think that the one of my concerns about this school district is the need to reach out to other parts of the country where there are similar districts there are, because we're not typical of every district in the state. There are some that are similar, and we need to be very clear about what kind of benchmarking issues, if you use a TQM term, we ought to be looking for. And this is a very reputable national network, so that it has that appeal in looking for how do you do things well.
And it may center us to really concentrate on looking at what we are doing, what is wrong, what is driving the system the way it's being driven.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And I think there was an attempt last year in looking at the honors program with the partnership of parents and staff. And there was a report that came out of that, and I think the rest of the board needs to be, have that shared with them. And this could also be a part of looking at the possibly at becoming a member of the coalition.
Is there a way we could read that report before the workshop with the high school?
Yes, I believe the superintendent has a copy.
I thought you had it. I think, did you not get that last?
Which report are you talking about?
The one on the
advisory
committee that did not go to the board?
I thought it did, but.
So did I, last June.
We didn't get
I can see that you get copies, for sure.
Oh, yeah, we have copies.
Pardon?
I think we got it.
I think you got it in June.
It was part of communication and.
We didn't have
but it was not on our agenda.
That's right.
That's
correct. It's not an agenda item. We talked about it at a board meeting. It was going to be talked about at a workshop this fall.
You gave it to us along with another
computer.
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 Right.
We did receive
it. I'll see that you get another copy.
Okay. Thank you.
Did you have something else to cover?
No, I was going to say that I served on both of those committees, and I remember that. It was a CC to all board members, and it arrived with the computer back in its.
It just wasn't an agenda item. So.
Correct.
And there was a lot going on at the end of the school. So. It would be of interest, I think, to the board to read that before our workshop. Any more comment on those? Can I defer to the superintendent to try to collate a little more? We now move on to new business, and the first is personnel requests. New teaching assignment, 92-93 school year.
We have one more appointment for the to round out our current year. You may recall, of course, that Mandy Garmin transferred to the Pine Cove and leaving an opening as the high school, and the new committee has gone through this process, and the nominee is Nina Miller. I included a sheet on her. She has been both a nurse and a nurse educator for a number of years. One of the reasons why I think she was particularly interesting to the interview committee, she has worked in drug and alcohol education programs in the New York BOCES system, working on a curriculum K-12, and of course that is one of the issues that, that do crop up in the high school, and so I would nominate Nina Miller for the part-time nurse position.
Entertain motion.
I have a question first.
Yes.
Is this a 0.6 or a 0.8?
0.6.
I move that we nominate Nina Miller for the high school 0.6 nursing position.
Peter, second.
Second.
Peter, second. Any further discussion? I would like to make one comment only because I've served on the interviewing committee for the social worker who's currently on staff. And I see with this particular person coming on board that we are going to have a very strong team in dealing with health and social concerns of our high school population. And I see a very proactive teaming going along with our health educator, injury care, I would strongly support this nomination. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Next is a request for unpaid leave of absence.
Included in your packet, the request that came to me last week. It is a request, of course, that I think I were looking for the ideal time for requests. I would not choose this way of coming to these decisions, but as I have explained to you in the packet as well as some of you individually, it's essentially a personal decision. Teacher who has been with the system a number of years, and her request is to have an unpaid leave of absence starting with the second quarter of this school year. I realize that does in fact raise some issues. There are questions of what the school system is able to do. We are, of course, confident that at the sixth grade level we can find a suitable replacement. I think I should point out the teacher is aware that this is an issue for the children. Is feeling very motivated to do what she can to make that a good transition. And for the record, that is a request from Janet Nesson, who is a sixth grade teacher.
Any comment from the board?
It's for the remainder of this year, not one full year. Is that
no, right? It's for an unpaid leave of absence for the three quarters of the year.
And she intends to come back?
Well, that's the point of the asking for an unpaid leave of absence is not a money issue for the system. It's a matter of hiring somebody for the year only, which we would probably do anyway. When we have openings at this time of year, we tend to fill them with one-year positions. We make it clear to the person we put in that, of course, it's in the nature of a long-term substitute, but frankly, when this kind of thing occurs, and we do have, of course, personal issues that come up for people, we do hire with the expectation that it's a one-year position to be reviewed at the end of the year. So it works both ways, both the person we hire in for staffing reasons and for the person who is coming back. They have an obligation to let us know whether they're coming back or not if the contractual deadline is March 1st.
It is my understanding that parents and children of her class have been notified.
Yes, it is.
Has there been a lot of response?
I have only had one direct phone call myself, and I was out of the building at the time, so I didn't actually take the phone call, but I was informed. But I do know that there have been some comments.
And what is the purpose of the leave?
Well, it's not a leave with a necessarily a school-related issue. It's a personal issue.
I did receive phone calls from three of the parents in that class who were somewhat perturbed that their children were placed in this class, apparently with great forethought. And some of the parents had spoken with the teacher in the first couple days of school and had no inkling that this was going to happen and feel somewhat betrayed by this situation. Having a teacher start the year and then immediately ask for a leave. And some of them were suggesting that if she is going to take a leave, it might be better for the kids if she left sooner rather than later, as she has not established a relationship with them so far. But frankly, I think we have a bigger issue here in terms of some of these requests for leaves are, if you have a personal emergency, that's one thing, or if you have an educationally related thing, that's another. But if you just have a personal matter that happens to come up 3 days after the school year starts, I think I don't find that really very acceptable. Not an acceptable outcome for the children.
This may be an issue that we may need to look at from a policy standpoint. And at this time, I don't think it has a bearing on this particular request, but I would recommend that it go before the policy subcommittee. Any further discussion or comment? Rosemary?
I just think it may be unfortunate that this opportunity or situation arose when it did, but I do think that where this is a self-contained classroom with a very specific and directed teaching approach, that there are people who could be, if not equal to, at least appropriate for the students in the class. And I think that we ought to have a policy on this that is clearly communicated.
But I do find it a little disturbing that people would go, you know, for part of a year. But on the other hand, I don't know how hard it is for, you know, the superintendent to find an adequate replacement. And I think Ann, you know, put the finger on the most important thing, is how does this affect the children?
How difficult is it? I mean, you know, school has started and most teachers have been hired. What is the school for?
Well, at this grade level in this area of certification, there are certainly well-qualified candidates available. We should probably re-advertise, and I think that would be experienced this summer, you know, what we saw at various grade levels, but we need to believe that we will get a very good response if people are interested. So I don't think that's really the issue. The issue of somebody planning to be there, wanting to be there, kids being acclimated, and I understand that that is a concern for people. Frankly, I think it's a concern for this teacher, too. She's not unaware of that awkwardness. Having said as much, here we are.
I think if we grant this leave, I think that we should instruct the superintendent to start immediately in interviewing, advertising and interviewing, and if possible, bring her on board as soon as possible to help make the transition once the teacher is here.
Can we do that?
Sure. She's under contract.
Well, I think that the situation is such that my confidence would be that this teacher would be more than willing to do what's best for everybody involved. I don't think that she has anything, as far as the children are concerned, in mind, except doing the best she can. Yeah.
Even if we brought that person on as a substitute until the transition.
Sure.
Would you mean you would have a dual teaching, yeah, both of them?
This is not an uncommon solution to some of these problems, to bring in people so that there is a transition period. That I have certainly done that as a superintendent a number of times, and found that it pays great dividends. The amount of money that's involved is well worth it. And this is a teacher who is, frankly, as far as money is concerned, we are not likely to be hiring somebody at her level. So we will have the money available from the changeover.
I would just like to say that I've talked with a couple of parents about this particular issue as well, and in talking with the family this afternoon, that very plan came forth as we were talking about transition. And the teacher being very concerned and very committed to making a smooth transition as far as personnel, as far as comfort of the classroom, and as far as quality of the programming that's going to be offered. And a suggestion that perhaps they work together for a couple of weeks. And I know that Janet is very interested in doing that and very willing to do that as soon as we find someone to come in and work in that classroom with her. And has spent time today talking more with her class. I got a note from her class today, an invitation to come and meet with them to get their input on the kind of person that they would like to have and what they think some of the needs of their classroom are as we look towards the replacement process.
No further discussion.
I would just like to say that I think Ms. Hanson is a fine teacher, and if she wanted to leave and come back, I'd like for that to be a possibility for her. And I think if we don't think for this, then
we will lose the
teacher. And whether she does or does not, I'd like for her to have that option, because I think she's a fine teacher.
I would concur with that.
I may be in a minority here, but I really think that as a school system, we bend way over backwards to accommodate most teacher requests. And frankly, you know, I just feel like I see time after time the teachers' needs are met to the fullest, and the kids' needs are not always met. And, you know, I talk to a lot of parents who feel betrayed by this kind of situation and feel like we do nothing but meet the teacher's request. I don't think that's totally accurate, but I must say, you know, we're looking for all kinds of ways to make this okay for the teacher and relieve her guilt level. But, you know, what about these kids? I heard about kids coming home crying last night. Some of these kids aren't having the easiest time with school as it is. And, you know, I just think it's where we can avoid this kind of situation. We truly should. And I don't like sending the message that, well, we don't like it, but we're just going to continue to grant these requests because we seem to do it time after time. And we clearly need a policy. Frankly, I would hope we wouldn't need a policy, you know, to have teachers not leave or, you know, announce they're leaving 3 days after school starts. But I guess we do.
Well, the problem, one of the problems, is that if you don't have some flexibility, then there's the possibility that the teacher, in order not to lose the job, would stay against his will or her will. And that probably wouldn't be a very good year for anybody.
Well, then we're being held hostage to these kinds of situations where, you know, where we can't win then. You know, I just don't think this is a responsible state of affairs to be in. And I really think we need to send a message that, you know, when you sign your contract for that year, it has to be an extenuating circumstance that can be clearly explained to everybody why you would operate this way.
Well, that is the most difficult point for me anyway, is that I'm discussing this in a vacuum. I don't know the reason. And maybe it's appropriate that I not know it and that nobody know it. But that certainly does make it very difficult for me to decide this in terms, not so much of the individual, because I agree with what Laura has said, but the precedent that it sets. You know, are we going to... what is our policy going to be?
I see it as part of the superintendent's role to consult with the administration as well as individual teachers about issues where some of these things come up. There are requests that you never hear about. And I think that this is important. I think I have to take responsibility. I think the staff, I know of issues that each of the administrators has dealt with where we have canceled somebody pretty much along the lines that you're talking about. From time to time, things occur that no amount of counseling, administrative counseling, is going to deal with. I think the reality in this situation is we have a successful staff member who has, in fact, made up a decision that came unexpectedly. And it is largely a personal decision, is aware that it is not her first choice in the way in which she would like to deal with obligations. In spite of that, is making a decision that where she will be leaving. And I think our choice right now, frankly, is the message you give. And I think I hear it very clearly, and I certainly think it reinforces some of the conversations the administrators and I have had with individual staff members, that this is regarded as awkward. As you said, there are parents, there are children who are now feeling awkward about it. A staff member is feeling awkward about it. And to the degree that that message can help people make decisions, I think that needs to be answered. Right now, tonight, however, we are faced with a reality, and I think we just have to make a decision.
I would probably concur with the superintendent. I think we have to address this particular situation. And if we can make the transition easier for the children and family, then my recommendation would be, again, to the superintendent to advertise, hire, and if possible, transition. Rosemary.
Mr. Chairman, if you're ready for a motion.
I'm ready for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the request by Janet Nessen for an unpaid leave of absence for the balance of the 1992-93 school year, and that we direct the superintendent to pursue immediately her replacement, including a possible transition period.
I think she's asking for at the end of first quarter, not immediately.
It is November 3rd, I think.
November 6th.
Since it has a little seconded, would you like to change your motion?
Actually, what I thought I heard was that if a replacement is available sooner, then that replacement should come sooner.
But she'd still stay there.
But she would still stay.
It would be as a team transition to make the adjustment teacher and students.
I will correct my motion to say for the
remaining three quarters of the year.
Thank you. Sorry.
Does everybody understand the motion? Would anybody like to second the motion? Loretta seconds the motion. Is there any further discussion on this recommendation for a leave of absence and the instructions of the superintendent? Seeing none, I ask for a vote. All those in favor? All those opposed? 5-1 and standing. Okay, next under new business, approval to receive and spend all federal and state grants for the 92-93 school year. There's a letter to the superintendent, D. LaBelle, concerning this.
This is a situation, we're not asking for approval of the necessarily of the funds. Those are funds that come to us, but the federal requirements, federal programs require a board vote in our minutes. All of these applications are accompanied by a copy of the minutes where a vote is recorded that you allow or back or however the term is used, the use of funds for these purposes. I don't think there's any change here in any of these forms from what you've seen in the past. Chapter 1. Essentially, of course, is the reading program. Chapter 2, much smaller amount, is used for almost entirely for media center purchases. Lyle handles our drug-free grant funds, and those are purposes that's been used for. He's extremely conscientious in the paperwork that goes with that, as well as trying to make sure that that's track well. I know I've had several conversations with him about that one. By the way, Chapter 1 is administered under the Special Education Office, although the teacher, Mary Gravel, our Chapter 1 teacher, is actually evaluated and supervised in the regular program, but also is sort of monitored, if you will, on the Special Ed. Chapter 1 is not necessarily Special Ed, but it's there is some natural monitoring that goes on in that. Local entitlement, again, is special ed funds. Those are the kinds of issues that school districts usually use for that. As you'll notice in that list, specialized equipment, physical and occupational therapy, adaptive physical education, consultancies and evaluation, speech services, in addition to what we have available for our own staff. Follow the child, which is a very small sum of money, but one that is tied to consultant services in specific areas and so on outlined. And finally, the Title II Eisenhower Act, a small sum of money that's been used, coming very, very handy for our math education and science program. We typically spend that on sending staff to workshops in those two areas, but we've also used it for in-house staff development.
Question regarding the drug-free grants. The last item is listed as K-3 awareness. Did we describe it as K-3, or was that the way the money came? We're K-4 now.
Okay, that was we described it as K-3.
We did ourselves.
I believe it was through the. I have to check my law, Rosa.
But that is targeted as a separate piece. Actually, this one. I'm not sure. Have we made out this year's application yet? I know we're in the middle. Their cycle is such that we're finishing up one cycle and beginning another.
Well, the community team is reviewing it on tomorrow. So that's okay. One of the reasons. I mean, if it should in fact be K-4,
I suspect that's a good point. And I think I'll put a note here to check on that one too, to remind me.
I'm not sure if for some reason or other, do either of you know? Was there anything specific about the K-3? I suspect that may simply have been because that was that building last year, so we'll check to see if the grade is okay. Thank you.
This might be a silly question, but in terms of how these monies are spent, do they just kind of get thrown into the pot of the particular area?
We have to be extremely careful. The federal accounting process is far more. In fact, this ninth secretary, Sue Coffey, is the person who fills out these forms. They come in multiple pages with many, many questions, with an auditing backup, and with the average application blank must be at least 10 pages long, isn't it?
I'm not talking about financially. In terms of how the services are delivered, does it just go into a...
Right. I mean, we don't... the interesting thing about Chapter 1 funds, school districts get Chapter 1 funds based on your free and reduced lunch count. That's a federal program that was intended as a compensatory program, and you are not allowed to use any of these. There are many stipulations for what you can use these funds for and what you can't use them for. And the major issue for Chapter 1 is it is it's an additional fund. You can't use it to supplant. It's a compensatory, not supplanting kind of fund. In other words, we can't hire one of our regular second grade teachers with Chapter 1 funds. Even if she did, she was a crackerjack reading teacher and that was her focus, we have to use it as a separate additional program. That's one of the guidelines that as you get into this kind of thing. Other than that, when you get down to local entitlement, as long as it's through the identified special education stream, there are many uses, for instance, that we use, and some of those we pay for out of local funding, and some of it we use the additional funding from local entitlement, which is the way it's intended to be. But the monies themselves have to be separately tracked and accounted for. Is that your question?
We don't need to press.
Oh, believe me, the red tape on any, you know, there are times when I have spent for $9,000 or $10,000 on Chapter 2 funds over the years. I have probably spent, on an hourly rate, I've almost worked that much just in filling out the paperwork and so on and so forth. Oh, that's an exaggeration. But you can certainly spend a lot of time with some of these small federal grants, like the $3,000 or the $1,000. In just plain tracking it, so it is accounted for.
Well, I've been spending about 3 or 4 days a month for the last 6 months running these things down, mostly in Washington. But we came across one on Thursday and looked at it, where the government has $1,600,000 for the James Madison Fellows. Yeah. $1 million of it goes to administrative costs, and $600,000 of it goes to the fellowship.
That's terrible.
Yeah, but it's just precisely what you were describing, that you have $362 or something and you spend 4 hours of your time.
Four?
Not the damn form, right?
Yeah, well, it's more than that.
It's probably worse proportionally. We have so many programs down there that it's it gets pretty discouraging. But
Peter, I might point out to you that we spend about 2 hours a summer just calling the department and asking them what they mean by it.
And dare I ask if, do you get any answers?
Dare I answer?
Well, we discovered another program called ALAS, and we thought that was very aptly named.
Giving out the William Proxmire.
We've got about 10 of them ready for our report. We just don't know how to deliver them diplomatically.
Well, I think I don't want to be misunderstood. These monies are all well used and well appreciated. We do appreciate it. Far less than 10 million.
I need a clarification on Chapter 1 funds. You said that's based on our hot lunch?
Free and reduced hot lunch funds. Because it is a federal program for compensation for children of need. Now, interestingly enough, you use the funds to, for the purposes of what we used to call remedial reading, we call it various other things now. And that's not to, in other words, you don't have a child in the program who has to have a poverty level or something, you know, some kind of an income basis to get into the program. It is within the guidelines of the program. We use it for this program, and the kids are in there through identified needs. But the money is tagged to that level. In some large districts, for instance, elementary schools are called Chapter 1 schools. And if you're going to have 10 or 12 elementary schools, that will be because some districts or some elementary schools may be in a part of the district where there is a high percentage, a high concentration of children who pop out into any of those economic indicators.
My sister, who's a Chapter 1 teacher in another school district, covers two elementary schools, and her budget's $100,000 is what she gets in Chapter 1.
That's obviously an indication. Well, of course, there are two factors. There are the number of children, but also the income level.
I was just reflecting back on the Finance Subcommittee's meeting and the report on our increase of free lunches and reduced lunches this year over past. And what this would reflect in our Chapter 1 funds next year.
Can I just clarify something on that point, Charlie, because it's somewhat important. The funds level is established for each town on the basis of a fairly complex formula that has many factors of economics in it. The free and reduced lunch count is used to make a school eligible for receiving services. It doesn't establish the fund level. That's the other formula set by the department, and it's very complex. It's probably the most complex one in education. Not many of my colleagues understand it. And but there is a difference in those two things.
But could your funds go up because your economic situation change in your community?
It can. It would have to be quite an appreciable change in the community's economic factors. For example, how many children in town are under the care and custody of the Department of Human Services is one of those. How many unemployed folks are there in town is another factor. It's how many single parent families are there is another. It's a very complex formula.
It's funny, I've been on the board 3 years. I've looked at these these fund accounts from month to month and never truly understood how they were calculated, how they were funded. I understand where they went and what they were used for. Any further discussion? I'm ready to entertain a motion. Rosemary.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we authorize the Cape Elizabeth School Department to receive and expend the funds, the federal funds through the state of Maine for the six programs outlined in the September 10th, 92 memo from the business manager.
Your second. Chairman, second. Discussion. All those in favor? 6-0. Finally, under new business, nominations for coach and co-curricular positions for the 92-93 school year refer to the superintendent.
And they are math team grades 5 and 6, Gary Record, math team grades 7 and 8, Charlie Hanna, student council middle school 2, appointees to share the stipend, Anine Stanford and Andy Strout, and signed chorus, Gail Parker, and under coaching assignments, 7th grade girls soccer, Joellen Rand.
Any discussion? Entertain a motion.
Did you say all those names?
No.
Okay. I move that we accept the co-curricular and coach assignments now to 92-93 school year.
Okay, here's a second. Rosemary. Further discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. A consideration of a, well, first, I just want to remind people that the next school board workshop is on Tuesday, September 29th, 1992 at 7:30 p.m. in the high school library, and it will be essentially on the high school and the coalition school application. And our next school board meeting will be Tuesday, October 13th of 1992 at 7:30 p.m. in the council chambers. I now consideration of a request by the superintendent to enter executive session for the purpose of discussing the status of administrative contracts and update on teacher negotiations. Entertain a motion. Rosemary.
So moved.
You can't say
that. That's not enough.
That was pretty
clear. I read the motion. You got that, Sue?
Yeah.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Peter, second. Any discussion? All those in favor, 6